As the conference has progressed, we have, I believe, inspired some announcements that weren't anticipated, and so we would like to recognize some of our participants now who would like to make some announcements that should be quite amazing. So first, I would like to call on Kenrid Dorset, the Minister of Environment and Housing from the Bahamas. Mr. Minister.
Firstly, Mr. Secretary, let me thank you for your leadership and kind invitation to this summit. The Bahamas, as many of you may be aware, is an archipelago comprising over 700 islands and keys, of which only 30 are inhabited. The Bahamas spans over 100,000 square miles, and 94% of my country is comprised of the ocean. We are truly an ocean state, where we have created a legislated sanctuary for sharks, manta rays, and turtles. Today, I am pleased to announce the formal passage of the Bahamas Protected Area Fund legislation. BPAF is a model piece of legislation developed with wide stakeholder consultation and input, which establishes a new trust fund dedicated to ensuring reliable and long-term sustainable funding for the management of protected areas within the Bahamas. BPAF should receive annual funding from the Regional Caribbean Biodiversity Fund. In addition, BPAF will be capitalized by funding sources within the Bahamas, such as fee mechanisms and levies, and donations from domestic and international sources. I would also like to announce that in this upcoming budget, the government of the Bahamas has committed $2 million to fund the BPAF. The Bahamas is certainly very proud to be the first Caribbean Challenge Initiative country to establish its Protected Areas Fund and the first to contribute to the endowment of that fund. Since the launch of the CCI in 2008, we have declared 6 additional marine protected areas. While we are proud of the increased protection provided, there are more critical marine and coastal ecosystems in need of protection. Therefore, I am also pleased to announce today that by the end of this year, 2014, my government intends to significantly expand our marine protected areas system, taking us from the current 3% of nearshore marine protected areas to more than 10% protection. To facilitate this expansion, earlier this year, my government endorsed the declaration of 15 new MPAs across the country. Public consultation on the proposed boundaries of these areas began last month by my ministry, and the dialogue will also include expansion of the protected areas to 20%, which we have committed to do on or before 2020. Not only will my government declare new MPAs, but we will also use the Marine Protected Areas System of the Bahamas as a catalyst for the development of a blue economy, which we truly believe will empower Bahamian communities surrounding these MPAs throughout our archipelagic chain. I thank you for allowing me this intervention, Mr. Secretary.
Mr. Minister, I'd now like to call on Ted Waite, the founder and board chairman of the Waite Foundation.
Could you hold for him? Oh, you want to slide over here?
Give me a little more.
Oh, you sure you don't want me to hold it? Okay. Thank you, Undersecretary, for having me, and thank you, Secretary Kerry, for convening this event. It's action like that that's going to truly make the difference. So I commend your leadership. Since the Waite Foundation dedicated itself towards the cause of ocean conservation about 5 years ago, we've granted tens of millions of dollars primarily for the creation of large marine protected areas. I'd really like to congratulate those countries that have taken the political will, like you said, Secretary Kerry, because that's really the key to create these networks of large marine protected areas. Countries like Palau, Kiribati, now the Bahamas, now the United States as well. So I really applaud you for taking the political will to take these big steps, because as the President Palau said, the science is clear. These networks of large marine protected areas are truly, truly a key part of the overall solution to sustainably managing our oceans. So I have three announcements to make. I'm going to try and be as quick as possible. The first announcement, when we first got started in the creation of these large marine protected areas, one of the problems was nobody knew what percentage of the ocean was actually protected. So working together with MCI, the Marine Conservation Institute, we created mpaatlas.org. It tracks around 6,500 marine protected areas around the world right now. And if you look at it, states there's about 1.8% of the ocean protected. That's almost double than when we started 5 years ago. It doesn't include the announcements made here today, so we look for that number to go up. So our big announcement is we've now added campaign tracker to that site, so you can track campaigns for marine protected areas around the world. We wanted to be able to track not only the number of sites that are actually protected, but also how many sites are actually in the works and in order to be protected. Eventually, we hope to be able to add, you know, the tools and things that it takes to help local areas create more marine protected areas. So that's mpaatlas.org, the campaign tracker. That was launched just recently. Go to mpaatlas.org. The next one is one of the things we noticed in marine conservation that seemed to be a problem is collaboration amongst NGOs. We wanted to have something in small-scale fisheries, as was talked about earlier by the World Bank. In addition to these large marine protected areas, we have to manage our artisanal fisheries better. So three of our grantees got together at our annual foundation, Environmental Defense Fund, with their work in fisheries management. Rare, who has launched pride campaigns around the world and does great work locally on the ground, and the Brende School from UCSB. So those three entities got together. The Brende School combines economics with ecology and biology to provide really economically viable solutions. So the three of these got together and created an entity called Fish Forever. Fish Forever is going to take turf reserves combined with small marine protected areas in coastal communities around the world. It's a very audacious project that we hope to scale from around 50 sites today in Belize, Indonesia, and the Philippines to over 1,000 sites. I've currently raised around $30 million. Hope to raise up to $100 million for this. It's a very aggressive thing to better manage coastal fisheries around the world. For more information about that, see somebody at the Waite Foundation. And the last announcement we have to make is the Waite Institute. The Waite Institute historically owned and managed oceanographic equipment like we used to find the black box for Air France 447. About a year ago, we changed our strategy to focus on really providing island nations with everything they need to do a full marine management plan. So we picked our first area called Barbuda, the small island that didn't have any marine management, had been devastated over the last few years. So we helped these countries walk through everything they need to manage things better, from the science, the mapping, the community consultation, the legal work, the enforcement plan. So we're about done with Barbuda now, and we have the capacity to take on one, even two additional countries a year. For more information on that, go to barbuda.waiteinstitute.org, and we're doing full marine management. So if there's countries that are interested in having a full marine management plan, we really act as like a consultant for you to help you walk through the steps that you need to develop the marine management plan you need. So those are my three announcements. Thank you.
Next, we have Elizabeth Wright Koteka, Chief of Staff to the Prime Minister of the Cook Islands, and Kevin Eero, a former professional international rugby player.
Excellencies, distinguished participants, ladies and gentlemen, please allow me to greet you in my mother tongue, mine and Kevin's mother tongue, and say kia ora. Kia ora means may you live on. Essentially, this is what we're doing here, is trying to ensure that we will live on this blue planet that we have. So, kia ora again. I congratulate the Secretary of State, John Kerry, the Department of State, and the United States government for convening this very important conference. And I thank you for the opportunity to tell you a little bit about the Cook Islands' story to better manage our bit of sea and ocean. In 2012, at the Pacific Leaders Forum held in the Cook Islands, the Prime Minister, the Honorable Henry Puna, announced the designation of 1.1 million square kilometers of the Cook Islands' 2 million square kilometers exclusive economic zone as the Cook Islands Marine Park, an area covering the southern part of the Cook Islands, including 7 inhabited islands. In making this announcement, Prime Minister Puna stated, "The Marine Park will provide the necessary framework to promote sustainable development by balancing economic growth interests, such as tourism, fishing, deep sea mining, with conserving core biodiversity and natural assets in our ocean, reefs, and islands." Since this announcement, we have conducted nationwide discussions with our communities on the key elements of the Marine Park, such as the outline area, use or no use areas, taking into consideration competing interests, management arrangements, compliance, enforcement, and so forth. These consultations highlighted the enormous task that we have ahead of us. These consultations also prompted the Cook Islands government to take several actions recently, which it is my pleasure to announce for the first time today. Firstly, commit to legislative changes in order to operationalize the Marine Park. Secondly, accept the overwhelming call from our communities to extend the existing no commercial fishing zone from the current 12 miles around each island to 50 miles around each island. Thirdly, recognizing the tremendous support to the notion that the entire exclusive economic zone that should be the Marine Park and that the Northern Islands must be included. The government has pledged the inclusion of the Northern Islands into the Marine Park area within the medium term. These commitments from our government will be positive steps towards what our people have told us that they want in the Cook Islands Marine Park. We are under no illusions that this will be a straightforward journey. In fact, the journey to date has been a challenging one, but more importantly, a worthwhile one. For we know that if we can pull this off, we would have created a groundbreaking plan that will harness the wealth of the sea and safeguard the ocean, like perhaps no other nation has done before. This will hopefully encourage other nations to follow. However, as we have heard yesterday and today, actions at the national level cannot have the desired impact without global support. Support such as backing the Small Islands Developing States' stance on an oceans goal in the Sustainable Development Goals in the post-2015 United Nations agenda. Actions such as control of the high seas and the exploitation of resources in these areas. Agreement on ambitious targets to reduce carbon emissions, and so forth. If I may, in closing, quote the Pacific Islands author Epeli Ho'ofa in saying, "We are the sea, we are the ocean, and we must wake up to this ancient truth." I think we have heard yesterday and today that the Pacific is waking up to this ancient truth, and we urge the rest of the world to also take appropriate action. Kia ora ana.
Next is Mark Spaulding, president of the Ocean Foundation since its founding 10 years ago. Mr. Spaulding.
Thank you very much, Undersecretary and Mr. Secretary. As many of you already heard, we announced today the formation of a pooled fund for donors to contribute to the implementation of the Global Ocean Acidification Observing Network so that it can fulfill its vision. Thank you very much.
Next is Naoko Ishii, CEO and chairperson of the Global Environment Facilities.
Thank you. Secretary Kerry, thank you so much for your leadership to bring us everybody here today. And you emphasize the importance of political will. and institutions like us, international organization, I think that the duty of us is to present or offer the right effective instrument to match the political will you mentioned. The problem of the ocean is its nature of global commons or tragedy of global commons. The ocean doesn't respect the man-made nature. The ocean's issue is such a multidisciplinary issue, so the solution, the effective mechanism, should be something like a platform which unites multiple nations, multiple actors, including the private sector, business, and the community, the CSOs, in addition to the national government or international institutions like us. And you already correctly mentioned, there have been a good example already here and there. Even just I see my own portfolio, the quickly two examples I can refer to. The first, ABNJ, Areas Beyond National Jurisdiction, which is about to be implemented with partners here today. It's basically that they're working on the high sea tuners, which includes that the private sector and the CSOs. Another example is our support for a Benguela Current Commission, which kind of created a legally binding the commission across multiple nations. But the Secretary, you are dead right, that those good examples are kind of scattered the here and there, which are not yet have a significant dent to reverse this worrisome trend. So the challenge ahead of us is how to translate those good examples, the success stories, into something that critical mass, which to make us close the threshold, which so that we can have a significant impact at scale. So my commitment to everybody here is to strengthen the multi-stakeholder platform or the framework for the coming years. The timing is perfect. The GEF just got the record-breaking replenishment from donors. That just the International Water received $460 million in grant. So my commitment, our desire, is to utilize these resources to strengthen or to create a platform, a multi-stakeholder platform, so that we can meet your political will to something concrete actions which could have a significant impact at scale. We have already have some good idea to how to work it out. We would like to work on the reverse the depletion of coastal fisheries. We would like to introduce that in a rights-based framework. We would like to apply, of course, the ecosystem-based approach, and we want to work to strengthen the institutions, fishery institutions. But the most important thing is that how we can break silos, how we can bring those stakeholders together so that the summation of those actions, collective actions, will be much more than just the sum of its part. So another important thing on this platform is that the introduction of the sustainable standards throughout the supply chain, which actually requires everybody's effort in the program. So our hope is that we would like to work with everybody to serve the 2015 Sustainable Development Agenda. Suri, thank you so much for promoting the GEF in your remarks. And one of our prime targets is the small island states, so that we are stand ready to work with everybody in this room. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much. We just have two more announcements. The first is from Lynn Hale, Director of the Marine Initiative at the Nature Conservancy.
Thank you, Secretary Kerry, and thank you to all the leaders for their inspiring commitments. Essential to achieving even our larger collective collective goal is to really change the way the world sees and values the ocean. Today, the Nature Conservancy is very proud to commit to a small step in making that change by announcing a three-year effort to map the ocean's wealth. Launched with a $3.8 million lead investment from the Lyda Hill Foundation, over the next 3 years, we will work with a wide range of partners, many of you who are in this room, to quantitatively describe, map, and make widely available information about the key services that the ocean provides so that we can collectively make better and smarter investments that support both conservation and economic development. The project will move from broad global averages to very specific regional and local details and making information in the language that engineers, policymakers, and others who really need to change how they make decisions can use. We do not intend, just to say it again, we do not intend nor can we do this alone. We need to work with others and invite all of those who share our vision to work with us as we are working with many of you through the Global Partnership for Oceans. So thank you.
Thank you. And our last announcement is from Sir David King, the UK Foreign Secretary's Special Representative for Climate Change.
Secretary Kerry, colleagues, the UK government has been playing a strong leadership role in global marine conservation and strongly affirms the need for partnerships in science, in risk analysis, and in management, but in particular in tackling threats at the moment to the implementation of the large-scale actions that we've heard about. We believe that climate change together with ocean acidification represent the greatest diplomatic challenge of our time. And I wish to embrace, for a moment, the small island states. Not only is the issue of ocean acidification, the loss of fisheries, the big challenge, but also a topic that hasn't been mentioned, rising sea levels. The British nation is an island nation. And we see an existential threat from climate change, and we sympathize very strongly with the position of those in the small island states. Foreign Secretary William Hague warmly welcomes the State Secretary Kerry's actions, and we are delighted to be represented here. The UK government's actions to date, if I can just run through them briefly, represent the establishment of two large-scale MPAs. The British Indian Ocean Territory was declared an OTAKE MPA in 2010. It covers an area of 640,000 square kilometres and at the time was the largest no-take marine area in the world. I'm delighted that this record is now being challenged. We are very keen to see that all of these no-take marine protection areas are declared and sustained. Secondly, we have a sustainable use MPA around South Georgia and the South Sandwich Islands. This covers about 1 million square kilometers, of which 20,000 square kilometers is a no-take area. In addition, we provide scientific analysis in backing up the nomination of the South Orkneys MPA in the Antarctic, and we're currently working constructively with the Pitcairn Island Council, with Pew and other stakeholders to examine a sustainable marine fisheries plan for the Pitcairn Islands and the seas around them. This is, of course, only a beginning. There's much more for all of us to do. We do need to look at both the small actions and those bigger actions that require support. But let me just quickly say, it is important for us to say that we face continuing threats to these MPAs that we are declaring. It is not an easy business to manage to keep them free from illegal fishing, harvesting, and hunting. And I declare that openly because I think we need to discuss further how actions can be taken to prevent these illegal actions that threaten what we're trying to do to manage our oceans. And so at this meeting, I very much welcome further discussions on how we can manage those threats. Thank you.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, I think we have heard some amazing commitments, very specific ones, by governments, by multilaterals, by our civil society, and by individuals. And this panel can show us what the way forward can look like when we all put our collective energy together to solving a problem. And I'd like to invite back Secretary Kerry to chart our path forward, where we're going to go from here.
This is our last meeting of the entire group in this room. There'll be a breakout group meeting here later in the day. But this will be the last session at which everybody will be assembled in the same room at the same time. And I just want to observe that over the course of my career, I've been to a lot of conferences. But I have to tell you, I've never been to one where people stayed in their seats, sat as attentive and as focused as you have, with as little movement and sort of break up and large gaps in the seating. I personally am impressed by the way in which there has just been a sense of serious purpose and intent here. And I congratulate and thank all of you for that. You're the ones who brought that sense of urgency to this effort here. I might say that by being so rigid and so firmly planted, we can say with certainty that the oceans movement is a hard-ass group of folks. What's amazing, I sat there listening to the folks who felt inspired to contribute beyond what had been previously thought would occur. And so out of this conference has come more a commitment to a combination of effort with respect to climate and oceans, but specifically focused on acidification and sea level rise and all the special efforts of these recent spontaneous announcements that you have made. And I'm particularly grateful to the minister from the Bahamas and the Bahamas Initiative, which is so critical, to Ted Waite and the Waite Foundation. I can remember meeting with Ted in San Diego a long time ago when he sort of focused and told me he was really going to put his energy and focus into the oceans. And he has done that tremendously and importantly. The Cook Islands, Prime Minister Fuller, we thank you for your contribution today for a 50-mile zone, which just really moves people away from areas of greatest accessibility and will have a significant impact. Mark Spaulding, the Ocean Foundation, and the Global Environment Facility, creating a platform for action, and Lynn Hale and Nature Conservancy, a $3.8 million investment in the Marine Initiative. And finally, are my friends from the UK, William Hague, and his representative, Special Representative for Climate Change, and the effort to work on partnerships and recognize this is indeed an enormous diplomatic challenge to bring countries together in multilateral forum. This has been as delightful a group of committed activists, scientists, academians, NGOs, civil society, and government representatives who've come together with a serious purpose And I think everybody deserves their mutual congratulations. Out of this, particularly with the remarkable contribution and seriousness of purpose expressed by the government of Norway, we have today received commitments for action and over $1.45 billion. And that is all directed at ocean effort. In addition to that, with some new commitments, we're soon going to be halfway to the number of countries needed to ratify the Port State Measures Agreement so that it can enter into force. And I will personally engage in efforts, and I hope others here will join, particularly my minister colleagues, in the effort to push to get that done. When we achieve that, we get a few more countries on board, we'll be able to take an enormous step forward in preventing illegally caught catches, illegal fish catch, from making it to the market. Finally, right now, only a small fraction of the world's ocean, as we have all talked about it, is currently protected. But with the announcements that have been made here today and over the course of this conference, and additional announcements at lunch, including the announcement President Obama made this morning, we're potentially on the verge of protecting more than 3 million square kilometers of the Pacific Ocean. We need to do more elsewhere, but that is a terrific start, and I congratulate everybody for their part in doing that. We have a lot to do in a short time. There isn't anybody here who hasn't come here because they don't understand the depth of this challenge. And I am so appreciative for all of you taking the time, making the commitment to be here. Our hope was and remains, and it's something that I felt significantly in my travels, both as a senator and as secretary. I would talk to people, and you'd get a certain number of people who go to a conference in one place or another. But we haven't often enough been able to convene all of the stakeholders that are necessary. We don't have them all here either yet. We need to continue to push that, because when people come together like this, there is a certainty of purpose, a certainty of understanding the challenge, and there's a sense of unity and of breadth, scope, if you will, of people taking actions ready to move that in itself is infectious, as we saw today with spontaneous combustion presenting these additional efforts. We have to continue that. And I said at the outset of this, that is the purpose of this meeting. So our team has been assembling a compilation of the best practices and of those suggestions made here for those things that need to be done in order to get this job done. And we will be putting this plan out immediately this afternoon after this conference. Everybody here can go to it immediately on state.gov. It will be accessible. We will be working to promulgate it. We will be working to try to build a critical energy underneath it, to take it to the United Nations, to take it to other international organizations that could have an impact. And we will try to build this so that this will become, in effect, the guide for the steps that we need to take in order to protect our ocean and in order to encourage other nations to sign on to do the same. Eventually, our goal is for this plan to translate into a unified global ocean policy. Now, governments obviously have an important role to play. We all know that. But what is proven here by TED and Nature Conservancy and other individual efforts here is that people, civil society, these young folks who are here, who are going to be, you know, tweeting and putting this out in social media and engaging, can begin to create a movement at colleges, universities, schools all across the world. This is something everybody can understand and force political action by virtue of making this a voting issue, where people feel that if they don't do this, they're not going to be running a government. They're not going to get elected. That's how it works most effectively. And lest any of you have any doubt about that, let me tell you something. When I first came back from Vietnam back in 1969, 70, I didn't first begin to protest the war. I first began to be involved with something called Earth Day. Earth Day, 1970. And we organized. 20 million people came out of their homes and said, we don't want to drink toxic water. We don't want to have cancer thrust on us. We don't want to live next to a waste dump. And guess what? Those 20 million people then focused on 12 members of the United States Congress. They were labeled the Dirty Dozen, the worst votes on the environment in Congress. And in the next election, 7 of them lost. That sent a message up and down. That sent a message up and down the spines of the survivors, who then promptly voted for the Clean Air Act, the Clean Water Act, the Safe Drinking Water Act, the Marine Mammal Protection Act, the Coastal Zone Management Act, and they created the EPA. We didn't even have an Environmental Protection Agency until that happened. So, as we leave here, we need to remember the power of these facts, of these ideas, of this mission. And I just ask everybody here to think about one last thing. I will always remember the comments of President Kennedy in 1962 when he attended the World Cup, not World Cup, excuse me, the America's Cup. I have World Cup on the mind, you know. And he talked about our connection to the sea. That's a wonderful passage, and you should all go be reminded by it. But I just remind you quickly. He talked about how each of us has this special connection to the sea because we come from the sea. And you just have to measure the amount of salt and water in the human body and in the veins in our blood, and you understand that connection. And so we leave here with a special sense of that connection, but most importantly, thanks to all of you, we leave here with a special mission, a special renewed vigor, sense of commitment to what we have to achieve. I thank you all for being part of this effort. We will convene again. It'll be in Peru, and after that, maybe back here, we will convene again. Chile. Well, it'll be in Chile instead of Peru.